By now, you know of the tragic Midair collision that occurred at Reagan National Airport between American Eagle Flight 5342 and a U.S. Army Black Hawk helicopter. This is the worst aviation disaster in the United States in the past 15 years. How did this happen in one of the most highly regulated airspace systems in the world? And what does it have to do with Swiss cheese? Let's unpack what we know so far about the crash. Specifically, the Midair collision occurred at local time 8:47 p.m. on Wednesday, January 29th, at approximately 200 feet AGL, and within seconds of Flight 5342 touching down on Runway 33 at DCA. Tragically, all 64 souls on the jet, as well as the three military helicopter crew, perished in the accident. Among the victims were former Russian world ice skating champions Yevgeny Shishkova and Vadim Nomov, as well as several U.S. figure skaters, their families, and coaches returning from skating championships in Wichita, Kansas. Flight 5342, a fully equipped 70-seat Bombardier CRJ-701ER twin-engine regional jet built in 2004 and operated by PSA Airlines, was literally seconds from completing its 2-hour and 53-minute routine flight from Dwight D. Eisenhower Airport in Kansas to Ronald Reagan Washington National Airport in D.C., although it was on an IFR, or instrument flight plan, which under marginal conditions gives responsibility of aircraft separation to air traffic control, with the favorable weather conditions, it was likely cleared for a visual approach to land. More on that in a moment. The second aircraft was the venerable Sikorsky UH-60 Black Hawk, a versatile twin-engine medium-lift utility helicopter used by the U.S. Army for various missions, including troop transport, medical evacuation, and reconnaissance. This particular flight was a low-level priority air transport mission out of Fort Belvoir, Virginia. The helicopter appears to have been operating within the MTR, or Military Training Route 4. This is a designated 10 nautical mile wide flight path, like a highway in the sky that helps in managing air traffic, which, surprisingly, appears to intersect the final approach path to Runway 33 at Reagan National. Before we go any further, let's take a look at the incredibly complex multi-layer airspace they were operating in. First, they were inside the freeze, or flight-restricted zone, which is within the DCA Class B airspace, which itself is within the SFRA, or Special Flight Rules area, each of which has their own respective entry requirements. Working outward, we start with a freeze. This is a highly restricted inner core within the Class B and SFRA, with a 15 nautical mile radius of DCA, with stringent security requirements for flight of only approved government, military, scheduled commercial, and pre-approved general aviation flights permitted. The freeze protects key government sites, including the White House, the Capitol, and the Pentagon. In fact, unauthorized entry into the freeze can result in interception by fighter jets or law enforcement aircraft. It's a big no-no. The next airspace level they were flying in is the Class B airspace, which per 14 CFR 91.131, requires all aircraft to have an operable two-way radio that pilots use to communicate with and receive clearances from air traffic control, to also have an operable Mode C transponder with altitude encoding capabilities, and to have an ADS-B, or Automatic Dependent Surveillance Broadcast. This is a GPS-based surveillance technology that automatically transmits an aircraft's real-time position, altitude, velocity, and other data to air traffic control as well as other aircraft. Think of it as a continuous automatic "here I am" broadcast that enhances aircraft location visibility for ATC and surrounding traffic. Additionally, since the CRJ carries up to 70 passengers, it is legally required to be equipped with a TCAS 2, or Traffic Collision Avoidance System version 2. This is an onboard automated collision avoidance system designed to alert pilots of nearby aircraft, both visually and orally, and then provide RA, or resolution advisories, to avoid mid-air collisions. Unlike ATC-based separation, TCAS 2 works independently and directly communicates with other aircraft's transponders to detect potential conflicts. Think of it as an aircraft's last line of defense before a collision. Also, if the aircraft is flying on an IFR flight plan, both the pilots and the aircraft must be IFR rated and certified, respectively. Note that DCA uses STARS, or standard terminal arrival routes, to streamline traffic on approach to landing. For safety, air traffic control typically provides a minimum horizontal separation of 3 nautical miles with a vertical separation of 1,000 feet for all incoming traffic at DCA. The last airspace level they were flying in is the SFRA that extends to a 30 nautical mile radius from DCA and requires all pilots to file and be on an active flight plan with a clearance and for the aircraft to have the Mode C Altitude Encoding Transponder, or ADSB out. Suffice it to say, there are multiple levels of security, safety, and control protocols in place for the densely packed airspace around DC. By the way, DC typically handles about 800 commercial flights daily. That's 33 flights per hour, or one flight every 2 minutes. From the airspace requirements, we can derive that the CRJ was indeed equipped with the required modern avionics suite designed to enhance situational awareness and also to prevent mid-air collisions. Its key systems likely included the ADSB out, the TCAS 2, the Rockwell Collins ProLine 4 avionics suite with a flight management system, or FMS, and GPS navigation that provides the pilots with traffic alerts and situational awareness information via the multifunction displays, or MFDs, as well as a Mode S transponder that continually sends altitude and position data to ATC radar systems so controllers can provide conflict alerts through radar advisory services. Interestingly, a former Black Hawk instructor I spoke with confirmed that although the helicopter also has an advanced redundant avionics suite applicable to its national security roles, it was likely not equipped with TCAS or ADS-B, meaning that the Black Hawk crew had no onboard warning, other than ATC verbal communications, of their relative proximity to the CRJ. This is the first hole in the Swiss cheese I mentioned before. By the way, the Swiss cheese model developed by Professor James Reason, a human factors and aviation expert, is a framework used in aviation safety and accident analysis to explain how multiple layers of safety can fail and lead to a disaster. It visualizes safety measures as slices of Swiss cheese, each with holes that, when aligned, lead to catastrophe. Now, this is key, and the second big hole in the Swiss cheese. Even though the CRJ was on an IFR flight plan, with the good weather and upon request, ATC cleared them for a visual approach. A visual approach means that the pilots have the runway in sight and use visual cues to safely land the aircraft instead of a GPS or ILS approach. The visual approach alleviates ATC from actively separating those aircraft from other traffic, shifting that burden over to the pilots. But the CRJ pilots were in the fast-paced, last-minute critical moments of final approach and likely had their eyes either in the cockpit or on the runway straight ahead and simply didn't see the Black Hawk. And at that point, with no automatic ATC safety net. That takes us to the third hole in the Swiss cheese. Flight 5342 had TCAS 2, and if the Black Hawk's transponder was on, the TCAS would have warned traffic, traffic, to the CRJ crew. But if the Helos transponder was off or didn't have ADS-B out, the CRJ TCAS would have nothing to report. Remember too, the Black Hawk crew communicated that they had the CRJ in sight. Could this simply have been a misidentification on their part? If so, that's the fourth hole in the Swiss cheese. If the Helo crew did see the CRJ, it was their responsibility to know they were looking at the correct aircraft and to avoid it. This is called situational awareness. But if the crew weren't 100% sure where the CRJ was, they were trained to roll level, rescan, and reconfirm. Was there confusion in the cockpit? They were also likely wearing night vision goggles as well. Could that have contributed? Why was the Black Hawk even crossing DCA's final approach path? We already know that the Helo was operating properly within the MTA-4, but did you know, not surprisingly, military flights get priority clearance, especially in this concentrated DC airspace. ATC typically works around military movements, providing altitude restrictions and warning military aircraft to stay clear of final approach paths. Sadly, in this case, that priority clearance unintentionally created a problem by allowing the Black Hawk to be in the right place at the wrong time. So this is the fifth hole in the Swiss cheese. With all these factors in mind, how did this tragedy possibly occur? In a perfect world, these two aircraft would never have come close. But tragically, that's exactly what happened. And now we mourn the loss of those on board. The NTSB, FAA, and regional authorities will continue to make this their priority to uncover what actually happened and to honor the victims by helping make commercial aviation even safer. Who do you think was most responsible? ATC? The Black Hawk crew? The CRJ pilots? Let us know in the comments below.